tell you later.
My name is George Petro, and along with my mentor and business partner, Eugene Jarvis, we're going to talk to you a little bit about the arcade business. I think Eugene's got something put together. He wants to tell you where it's been, where it's going, afterwards you guys can ask any questions you want about that. So without further ado, here is Eugene to start us off.
Thank you. So it's kind of a cool industry. I know you guys are into it, or you wouldn't be here. I guess it's, you know, the arcade scene has been around for, I don't know, like 100 years, you know, like since 1890s, 1900, the penny arcade stuff. We're going to talk about kind of the video subset of the arcade, and really the concentration is on the future.
That's what that says, by the way, down there. It's not FUCHA, or it's not an acronym for anything.
So, when you talk to someone, like you guys, when you go home to wherever you live, and people ask you, well, what did you do last weekend, you know? And you go, oh man, I was at this really cool arcade game show, and pinball, and video, and what do people say? They say you're crazy?
Yep.
It's cool.
Hey, this is our livelihood.
what they always tell me is, they go, isn't that arcade shit dead? You know, like, didn't that die, like, you know, 50 years ago or something? Back in the crash. And, like, forever. And in some ways, I mean, it has died. The peak pinball production, I think it was 1979, and that was about 200,000 pinballs being built every year. About 800 games a day, if you can believe it, which is almost like the run of a game now. You know, like, I think an average game today might sell 2,000 units or something. So that was in 79. Probably the peak of arcade video was in, I think, about 1980 or 81. And maybe probably 500,000 games a year. Now the video industry is probably, arcade video in the U.S. is maybe 20,000 games a year. So we're like, 4% or something?
It's decreased.
Down, we're only down 96%, man. It's not a crash.
Yeah, get in now. You know,
time to buy.
That's right. Time to buy.
Time to buy. And people always say that, like, the arcade wasn't that dead. You know, like, well, not really. I mean, there's still some stuff going on, but unfortunately, to many people, the golden age of the arcade is just a memory. And unfortunately, these home consoles have been kicking our ass. PC, like, we got PC, Steam, PS4, Xbox One, Wii U, Wii 2, Wii 3. I guess finally they'll come up with a Wii Wii. You know, that'll be the end of it all. These systems by the late 90s had actually surpassed arcade quality video. And we kind of got our butts really kicked.
I think the PlayStation was started.
Like, yeah.
The PlayStation kind of got games to arcade level, you know, pretty quickly. And they were cheap, too. I mean, everybody made games on the PlayStation. It was kind of open to every developer.
But I guess, you know, it was really like ColecoVision might have really started it just before the big crash. Now, when did you get into the industry, George? Oh, yeah.
So I got in, when did the industry crash? Like 83, 84, I think. So that's right when I jumped in. It was a great time to get in the arcade business.
You were all in.
I think Eugene had, his first game was Defender, right? So how many Defenders did you sell?
About 60,000.
60,000 Defenders. That's a lot of games. You count them up, it's a lot of games.
That's almost as many as down on the floor tonight, you know?
Right. and then Eugene's second game was Robotron. How many did you sell that?
That was like 20.
So 20,000. Oh, Stargate was second. Stargate. Yeah, yeah. What'd you do with Stargate?
It was maybe about 30.
Okay, 30. So Robotron, 20,000. And then I think 1984, you released it, what? Blaster.
Right.
What'd you sell the Blaster?
Like 600 or something.
Okay, so.
600,000?
Right, no.
600 million?
Right, so that's when I started at Williams, was in 1984. I think they had chains ready to put on the doors. Everything was, you know, everything was coming apart. So the arcade basically, you know, the whole arcade business had died at that point.
And I guess the home consoles were a huge part of it. Nowadays, we're also kind of online overkill, roadkill. You know, you got Facebook, Twitter, Amazon, blah, blah. It's hostile, agile, juvenile, senile, social, and mobile! And so basically the arcade went into cloud heaven. And, you know, who needs an arcade when you have one in your pocket on your phone? You know, it's like, what do we need all this, all these big, heavy games, lug around all this crap, the power supplies go out on them, the, you know, they just...
Monitors go out.
Your back hurts.
Controls go out.
Right, they have this things called CRTs. Like, what is that about, man? You know, it's like this big, it's like, it's got like 40,000 volts in there, man. You ever... Ever like sample that voltage in a CRT, man? It's like it's an interesting experience, you know. It's a electroshock.
It makes hair stand up, I think.
So now we got all this phone stuff, you know, Candy Crush. I mean, my God. I mean, how many people play Candy Crush here? Wow. You say, you know, even the hardcore, you know, Luddite, technophobe arcade people are sucked into the scene, you know. So, you know, we are pretty screwed.
All right, let's get to work.
But the question is, if it's so dead, then why is this stuff happening? And we should probably put Penberg on here, too. You know, we play FX. We need a big hand of applause for the organizers of Replay FX, man. Just give it awesome. I've never been to a pinball video arcade show with as many games as are out there. I mean, just to walk across that bridge and look down there and see like the sea of people and games, man, it's like, maybe we aren't so dead, you know? It's kind of cool.
It's pretty impressive, actually.
Yeah. So there's stuff happening, even though we are dead. But so we got a comeback, you know, how do we come back? How do we do this comeback thing? And, you know, it's... Obviously, it has to be something you can't get at home because, you know, we're like couch potato people. You know, you get on the couch and you got the remote and now you got your iPad, you know, and like you just don't get up. You know, it's like everything is there. You know, they I guess you need like some kind of intravenous soft drink dispenser. You know, like instead of a VR helmet, like VR soft drink, you know, tubes, you know, in your mouth. You just then you have to. I guess you have to. Deal with the output too. I don't know, but so
it's called a trough.
Whatever. Okay. Anyway,
just a channel in your floor.
Yeah. But okay, you can't. You know, you can't. You gotta. You know, if it's on your phone, if it's on the internet, you gotta find something different. So, what could that be? Any ideas? What is not on the internet on your phone? I mean, is there anything left?
VR.
That's one thing. Yeah. That's Redemption.
Hey now.
Okay, you guys are jumping.
I got tickets for you.
Okay, well, there's another thing, even more important. Beer! And so again, like beer, you can't download that from the internet, man, at least not yet. You know, I guess Amazon may have a pipe into your house one of these days.
A drone delivery.
That's right, drone. Yeah, drafts, drones and draft, man. So we got the beer cave, you know. So like, this is pretty cool. It's like you take like everything we have downstairs today, and you add beer. You know, it's like this is cool, man. So you got, you know, beer, classic vids, pinball, millennials, whoever the hell, whatever that is, you know. Anyway, whatever. Okay. And gentleman right here nailed it. You know, it's like you can't win stuff on the, at least like real live stuff that you can pick up right now. And so that's the other thing, like, you know, like instant gratification, you know, tickets, you know, so you can disguise the fact that you're really giving them nothing, so you give them a bunch of tickets. Merchandise, kids, it's all good. Redemption. So it's really cool. Things are cool. Can't do it on the internet. Then you got your merchandisers, which, again, you get stuff, it's right there, it's hanging right on the thing. And if you're like me, you may not have the skills to win, so you may have to just like turn the machine upside down or something, or get an axe or something to get your fries.
Or play it 800 times.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, that, I mean, there was a little issue there with Keymaster. That was actually, it's funny, I was talking to a guy, a nameless operator in a high traffic location, and he was saying, you know what, I was asking, like, well, how, you know, what kind of payout do you have to put on these things, you know, it's like, keep people playing them, you know, and he was like, you know what, no one, you know, it's like high traffic, shore type location, nobody is here the second day, so, and maybe only 2 days I'll be here, so, every night he just rearranges the prizes. It actually never pays out anything. And
it's when the prizes get like sun bleached boxes, you know, they're not going out.
Right, he finally had to take the VCR out of it. You know, it's like but the cranes, you got the claws, you got the merchandisers. It's cool. It's really cool to win these things. It's cool to grab the to win the frog or whatever. It's a great rush. The other thing we can do in the arcade is we got big stuff. You know, it's kind of interesting. Now the phone, which is something you have with you, is like killing the consoles, killing the PC, killing all this stuff. So it's killing off all this fauna that, you know, competitive animals that are still fairly small. But our competitive niche is like we're the, you know, the huge carnivores and elephants and stuff. And there's something about a huge game that you just, that experience cannot be duplicated on a phone, unless your phone was, you know, 10 feet by 10 feet. So it's really, you know, we have this physical, cool, big stuff.
So real quick, I had this question for you earlier. Okay. These two kids on there?
Yeah.
Is the kid on the right, is he like trying to do a happy dance, or is he gonna punch that kid? I don't know which one. He's smiling, but he's got his fist cocked. Right. He's like ready to go after him.
And that guy turns around, I think.
That is a competitive game.
Some brotherly love will go down. Right. So then, yeah, like the monster drop. I mean, anybody play the monster drop? I mean, it's like 50 feet tall, you know. And,
you could live in it.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. You could. Remember, there was like some guy that was living in a Walmart, you know, like in the inside of the shells or something, you know. Like, I mean, you could literally live in the bottom of this thing. And it's cool, man. It probably rains on certain days, you know. It's awesome. And then you got the Down the Clown. I love this. Like, these are some of the old Carny type games. Ice is bringing back. It's just cool. You throw a baseball at these things. And, very interesting. And this Fishbowl Frenzy. Have anybody seen this thing? It's, isn't it? It's super cool. They have like little LCD, I guess the whole thing is like a see-through LCD screen, and they have these little goldfish swimming in like little bowls. They actually stick out the bowls, and so it looks like a bunch of goldfish bowls with goldfish swimming around in there, and they don't poop, you know, it's pretty cool, and they don't die, you know, it's like,
water,
you don't have to change the water, and it's like, no algae, no, you know, it's cool. And then, of course, this is the crazy thing. It's like, now we're doing apps. We're basically ripping off the mobile. You know, it's like, after they ripped off all our shit and made us broke, you know, we're now ripping off their shit, you know. So now, you know, we got the Fruit Ninja, which is, it's a lot funner on like a 4-foot screen than like your freaking cell phone, you know. And the Doodle Jump. That was, a game that actually we did that for ICE, and so it was a fun, yeah, that's a really fun game. And this is the first time ever seen George as Play Mechanics Studio with ice.
Right.
Angry Birds arcade. This thing is like, I don't know, it's like 20 feet long and like 10 feet tall or something.
Yeah, can I shamelessly plug our company here? Like, keep Eugene on track. I mean, we do work in the business. So yeah, this is like one thing that really started happening in the arcades with all the apps, turning apps into arcade games. At first, when Fruit Ninja came out, everybody was like, oh, that's great, earns a lot of money. And then, of course, as our industry goes, everybody then decided, let's get app games. And then there's a plethora of app games. If you go to Redemption Center, you'll see where they'll put the app games all in one area. So the effectiveness of the app game really decreased quite rapidly.
Right, life
to the point where, you know, arcade owners said, we don't want any more app games. If it's an app game, done. So this one, when we ended up with the Angry Birds license, we said, we got to make it not an app game. So in this game, you actually physically shoot a bird. It's in ball form. It's like this Angry Birds.
So you have
ball.
Like a slingshot, but it's a physical slingshot.
You have the slingshot in the front, just like the game, and then you hit the structure straight on with the ball. And wherever the ball hits, it starts the structure falling down. So this one is really cool. We did a neat thing with Dave and Buster's with this where we released it last week, a week ago Thursday. It went to every Dave and Buster's simultaneously, and it's there till Labor Day weekend. So, you know, this kind of thing works really well. So we have to take the app game and then arcadeify it, if you will.
Well, it's kind of interesting, like the whole Dave and Buster's thing, because when did they start in, what, 80-something? 86?
Who knows? When was the first Dave and Buster's? It was early 80s,
maybe,
I think.
Maybe
it was... What?
Yeah, exactly. There you go. Yeah, it was a long time ago, and they have arcade games and beer. Oh.
Yes, they did.
They're the original freaking barcade, dude. So that's not even new, okay? This whole beer shit is old. Okay. Now,
might be older than that.
Okay. And then Flappy, you know, the highest quality game ever produced is also an app now. I mean, it's an arcade game, Flappy Birds. That drives me insane. I don't know. That game, it's like the poorest designed user interface in history. And so, but it makes it a challenge. You know, it's like, it makes something that should be like super easy into something that's nearly impossible. And somehow you think it's your fault, you know? When you should be like strangling the programmer, like, you know, like going out, you know, puncturing his tires and keying his car, you know, because he wrote such a crappy program. The guy's a fucking hero and he's making billions, you know?
I have to work with this, by the way, so. We'll be us the programmer.
Yeah. So, okay, and then the other thing we're doing in the arcade is we got movie games. And so this is a new one from Raw Thrills. Jurassic Park, it's in a lot of movie theaters and places now. Dave and Buster's, Chuck E. Cheese, all kinds of places. And really, you know, people love killing dinosaurs, you know. I guess they just want to kill anything, really. But since dinosaurs are extinct, you know, they can't come after you for killing shit. So it's
no,
okay.
No real dinosaurs were killed during the making of this game.
Yeah, actually we didn't even kill any pixels. Because they actually come back. They're recyclable.
Right. So wait, real quick, on this game, interesting story about this game when we were making it. One of our customers that we talked to about this game, I'd say last September, they came and sat with us and talked to us. They said, you know, video's dead. You know, we're not going to sell any video games anymore. It's not happening. Redemption's where it's at. So we released Jurassic Park in March, late February and March. And it's just, I mean, for some reason, this wasn't by any plan, but there was a Jurassic World movie coming out. For some reason, dinosaurs,
because we were so late.
Right, we were so late.
I mean, this was actually the license from 1995.
Right. So anyway.
And it took us so damn long to finish this game that it was like a perfect timing with a movie. I mean, it was brilliant.
It was brilliant. It's brilliant. But so the game really, I don't know, it was like a perfect storm for games. And this game just started earning money. People love it. They play it like crazy. So our customer came back to us and they said instantly, they're like, we can't call it a video game. It's got to be called a simulator or something because video's dead. So they wanted to call it something new. But we're like, you know, this is what we do. We make video games and we are not extinct.
Okay. That's cool. So yeah, that's a fun project. And then there's, of course, more movie games. Star Wars Battle Pod. How many? Any of you guys play that? You guys?
Yes.
And what was? Do you guys like it or?
Yeah.
It's cool. Cool stuff. Yeah. I mean, who could not? Who can't like Star Wars? You know what I mean? I mean, as long as Jar Jar Binks isn't in there, maybe it'd double the earnings if he was in there. You know, it's like,
I mean,
yeah, that would double the income. You know, it's like, but yeah, the cabinet, this thing is just insane. It's a, it's like one of these, you know, big projection kind of things. It just cockpit, it's all around you. You know, it's like, what do you call that stuff? Surround, like surround.
7D.
It's like IMAX. It's kind of like 8D. IMAX.
It's called motion sickness.
Yeah, well.
Do you get sick when you play it?
I get so sick, but I love it.
Yeah, well, you know, they have...
You're a true fan.
Well, if your puke hits the screen, you can actually kill things. You know? It's pretty cool. There's actually there's water jets in it. Like, if somebody pukes, the water comes on and just cleans it down. Ready for the next customer. Man.
It's like those automated toilets.
Right.
Don't get caught in it.
Yeah. Okay. And then we got, of course, driving games, which I love. This is our Superbikes 2 and Supercars games. I hope you guys get a chance to come to our booth. We have, like, really cool Batman driving game. And also we have Supercars and Superbikes there. And Snowcross. So, you know, driving games, I don't know, there's just something cool about driving games. You know, everybody wants to drive. And, I mean, kids love them. It just never ends. So it's something that's, you know, even, you know, I was out playing Outrun today down the hall there, and I mean, what a great fucking game that is. But man, do I suck, you know? It's like, I mean, it's tough.
Outrun,
man.
You suck at Outrun?
It's like, you know, they keep putting these cars in front of you, and you're like, those palm trees, and then like, it just...
Because you actually have to play it, right?
Yeah, it's brutal. You need skill, man. It's like, we gotta, you know, that's never gonna work today, man. We get it, you know. Everybody gets a trophy.
Skill kills.
Okay. So there was driving games, movie games. Now there's driving movie games. We're getting creative. We're cross-pollinating. We're thinking out of the box. And we got gun games. And like the big buck game, I mean, that is pretty awesome. It's pretty awesome. That's George's studio, Play Mechanics, put that one together.
You guys played it down there? Is that funny? I know. We like this game.
Yeah. Yeah, we've been... Actually, George has been working on this game for, what, like 20 years? How long?
Pretty much most of my life, I think.
Since puberty,
right? I think since 1999.
Damn. Yeah. That's pretty crazy. It keeps on getting better.
Yeah, it's good.
I mean, the original one was kind of like the deer... It's kind of like these stick figures, and they kind of limped across. It was a Special Olympics for deer, you know? And you shot them. I mean, it was cool. I mean, it was cool.
Whoever's recording, please edit that. Do not let that show up on the internet. I don't want to get the phone calls.
Anyway, but you try it now. I mean, it's like. There's 3D. No, they got this 3D. It's like the 3D, like, it's like hair. There's like 3D hair, right? I mean, it's like hair. It's like
Irwin.
They got 3D ticks on the freaking deer's ass. I mean, it is. Yeah, it's amazing.
Okay, so real quick, I'm gonna stop Eugene because. All this stuff starts making me think about Eugene a little bit, and I just got to tell the story because coming to Pinburg, I've never been. I don't think I've ever been to Pittsburgh other than driving through it, and Eugene gets this wild idea in his head that he wants to drive from Chicago. He said, let's road trip to Pittsburgh. And, you know, you're getting a little bit of Eugene's humor and craziness, and that also kind of leads over to his driving. So riding in a car with Eugene has been said to be life-threatening, harrowing, you know, it's not a good idea. So I finally convinced him to fly. So we flew in, but he wanted to rent a car, and I got to say, the drive over from the airport was like, you know that section where you come through the tunnel? I think, so he makes all these driving games, right? When we're coming into that section for the tunnel, there's traffic backed up on the right. Here comes Eugene going about 80 miles an hour, like right down that hill. And I'm in the passenger seat, and I'm just waiting for a car to come over. And, you know, I just feel really fortunate to be here. So if anybody can give me a ride to the airport on Sunday, I would love it.
Uber.
I'm not a member.
Okay. So, and then, of course, today, I mean, it's all about social. You know, it's like social.
Is that social, though?
It's social. I mean, it's everything.
Is that social? Is that social?
I mean, those
that's
guys
antisocial,
are,
right?
Fun, man. Check that out.
Look at how fun.
You know, that's a, you know, I mean, these people in the lower row here, though, it, look closely, those are actually flip phones. You know, it's like, you know, they got to upgrade. If they'd upgraded, they'd be a lot happier.
If they got upgraded, they'd be on the top picture.
Yeah, exactly.
They'd be waiting in the top picture.
That's right. It's a little more immersive in the top picture. But, like, that's social. Okay, like, is that social?
That's social.
That's social, baby. That's social. Right?
Another shameless plug. So this is our... This is kind of where we've gone with Big Buck Hunter. We've really, you know, we put this game online in 2008, and it gave us a really cool chance to get connected with the players and create, you know, all these events and create competitions over the whole country. And kind of, Callum was running an event here, just a high score event, just to get a feel for how competitive the game is. But we've been doing this now. This will be number 8 this year in October, just after the week after Pinball Expo.
Yeah, anybody wants a ride to Chicago, man.
Yeah, Eugene will drive you.
I'll drive you over.
And we get you know, the top players from all over the world come in and compete in a weekend of Big Buck Hunter, and it involves competition, money, and beer. So it's you know, or whatever else you want to drink.
I got an extra seat, I think.
Uber. So this is just really something that's grown out of the whole arcade business, and a great thing for the future to get us social in the public space.
Yeah. So yeah, it's cool. So it's and it's kind of, you can't just put a game out. You have to have kind of a whole rigmarole, you know, tweet. You got to like do a lot of tweets and shit, and, you know, get on. What else do you do? Facebook, you know, whatever the hell that is.
Do whatever we got to do.
You know. All right.
Whatever it is this week, we do it.
That's right. It's like. You got to, what's that, when this is commercial, it's like, when they're like, there's like Ubi, what is it? Like, everybody's doing Ubi, you know, we got to do Ubi, you know, it's like, oh, well, whatever. Okay, so, the arcade ain't so dead after all. So, so what's next? What's the next thing? You know, it's like,
oh, what is it? I'm dying to find
anybody,
out.
Anybody got any ideas?
You figure know? Out what I'll be working on Monday.
What's next? In fact, this is the ultimate system is right here. Your ass. It never goes obsolete.
And it never gets any smaller.
So
it's a growth market.
No, but here's, but you know, it's like. That's good, George. That's good, man. Okay.
Thanks. I'll be here all week.
Okay. All right. There's the, you know, it could be another bus. I mean, it's like you look, you know, like people are actually playing pinball games and shit. I mean, something's wrong. You know, it's like this could be, you know, like the next bus, and our great late friend Python. He loved to say this, you know, like every morning when he'd come in, he'd ask me, you know, how's the project going? And he's like, man, we are all so fucked. And it's just, you know, it's like, and there could be a bus. I mean, this could be, we'll think of Pinburg as like that last moment of like, you know, things are rocking and everything's going, like there's a new pinball company starting up every day and you know, people are actually playing video arcade games for a day or two. That don't have prizes. So, but yeah, so that could be one scenario, or the other scenario, which I think somebody mentioned, is VR, baby. VR, man, and this is like the holy grail of interactivity. And but then like somebody's, so you know, I always ask them about VR because I think VR is a pretty cool idea. But I was somebody
he talks about it all the time.
But some smart ass guy always says, well, like, didn't that happen in the 90s, dude?
It might be you me. Know?
Like, didn't that like happen? Didn't like it suck? You know, it's like, okay. So here's the VR thing. And this is actually that thing from this is Ivan Sutherland, who also, I think, did some of the first 3D simulation computers and software.
3D graphics.
Yeah, 3D graphics. And he actually created, it was not Palmer Luckey. It was Ivan Sutherland in 1968 who created the first VR headset. It's pretty fucking crazy. You know, and a brilliant genius. It looks like something from a sci-fi movie. That was real. And I guess around the same time, the guy invented the mouse. And that same, not him, but Douglas Engelbart. So it's interesting how a lot of the stuff that we are so into today actually was created back in the late 60s. And then, if you remember, John Lanier, who was a big developer of VR and a huge popularizer of VR. Does anybody remember John Lanier here? Back in the 90s?
Before the internet.
Yeah. All right, whatever. Okay.
He had really, browsers.
Yeah, they had like this data glove thing. Remember like those, remember Mattel had like the data glove or something? That was kind of channeling Jaron Lanier. And really cool, you know, the whole immersive thing. I mean, it was pretty cool. It was, you know, there was some issues. A gentleman before had mentioned some issues of stomach issues. There were some problems. And I guess, why didn't it take off, George?
I don't know.
Why didn't it take off?
Because it sucked.
That's actually John. He plays the flute. Yeah, he's pretty. I guess he's really good at that. I think he became a musician.
He lost the headset, though.
Yeah, he blew off the headset. But why did it suck? I mean, why did it vanish? You know, it was. I thought it was pretty cool, personally. So what was wrong? The resolution sucked, the frame length sucked, the response time sucked, the hardware and software sucked, the insanely expensive, you know, the only immersive experience was being immersed in vomit, which I guess, and we're still feeling that
we're
today.
Still there. We're still there.
So that was...
Does anybody remember that thing? Do you remember that deal?
That was virtuality. Yeah.
Virtuality.
Virtuality. I thought that was really cool. I mean, that was a cool game. I mean, that was, and really, was I don't that? Think, there wasn't a lot.
Yeah, oh yeah, like, two of them. They used to have them linked up.
Virtuality, this was in the early 90s.
Right.
1990s. I mean, it's amazing. And if you go to, like if you were at the GDC this year, they had a bunch of stuff just like that.
Yeah.
Probably a little bit worse.
Well, I was at E3 this year, and these things are back. You know, these, you get on them, but now they want you to walk around, right? So they put this, they make the bottom as like this curved surface. And so you have to, but what happens on a curved surface? What are you wearing? Are you wearing gym shoes or are you wearing street shoes? They make you put on those booties, like if you go into a new house, you know, and you put on the booties. So everybody's got these booties on and they're like walking around with a headset. It's just so stupid. I'm sorry.
You can't damage the hardwood floors, George.
I'm glad we're in separate offices.
So there were some issues. But now we're back in 2015, and this guy, Palmer Luckey, who is the new...
That's not Palmer Luckey.
No, that's not. Actually, he's not that much older. I mean, this guy, he's a freaking genius. I mean, he's like, he walks around with like flip-flops. And I mean,
yeah, and he got $2 billion.
Right, and he's like, he's like, you know, 15 or something, and
right.
And the dude, you know, $2 billion. He's got, you know, he raises $2 billion, and I guess they didn't put the $2 billion in the company. They kind of put it in people's pockets.
Yeah.
That's my kind of money raising.
Yeah. Huge mistake.
Yeah, that was kind of cool. But it's the Oculus VR. This was an early prototype, and. But how come we haven't seen, how come they aren't here? How come we don't have these at my desk, you know? I mean, where's my But where's my Oculus VR? I mean, this was like three years ago or something, right?
2 years.
2 years ago?
It's supposed to be a consumer
where
product.
Is my Oculus VR? And I was like, give me my Oculus VR or give me my check. That's what I say. You know, it's like, what's going on here? So how come Power Lucky got $2 billion and not a barf bag? So actually, a better resolution response, but I got ahead of myself. But anyway, I'm still asking why.
This is the next slide, right?
Where?
Here.
Yeah. Okay. Why is
just saying?
Where is my Oculus? You know, I mean,
I don't know. I don't have one. You know, where's my Oculus?
Yeah. What, you know, why isn't everywhere today? Because it still sucks. They don't talk about it. They just say, we're releasing it real soon now, and it's going to be a new version.
They have hand grips now. Yeah. Like they've added hand grips to it. That was the big announcement at E3.
Okay, hand grips. Okay.
Hand grips and Microsoft. I think they teamed up or something.
But still, so the technology really isn't there yet. And so we're still working on it. But why is Oculus important? So the important thing is by repopulizing VR, Palmer Luckey and Company unleashed a Zuckerbergian sharknado of cash chasing the next big thing, which is basically now he's got Facebook has like $100 billion, and so they're going after this thing, and now Microsoft, you know, has to go after, now everybody has to go in. There's probably half of you are making your own VR headsets right now, I bet. You know? I mean, it's like everybody's got to be in this thing. And so the result, actually that weird guy in the middle, that's Magic Leap. Has anybody read about that? Magic Leap? You guys gotta get out of the arcade every now and then.
Hey, wait a second. That's our business. hey, what are you saying?
No, this is very interesting. This guy's Magic Leap. It's down in like Orlando, or no, it's like
somewhere
down there on the in a beach, in Florida, and
the flip flops.
These flip flops, yeah. I used to wear flip flops, man.
You did. You used to wear Birkenstocks too.
Yeah,
you
don't do that. Right.
And white socks.
I know it.
You don't do that anymore.
Where's my check? Okay. No. Anyway, this is they actually shoot lasers into your friggin' eyeballs. You know, they call it the light wave field, blah blah blah. But what it is, it's shooting laser beams into your eyeballs, and I guess you can really. I mean, it's like screw the display. You know what I mean? You know. But it's like, what happens if the thing crashes, you know? You know, like, what is, the, you know, yeah, you get a blue screen.
Wait a second.
The blue screen, yeah.
We extract your eyeballs.
It's probably more like a red screen that's really, that's like, wah! I mean, anyway, they're working on it, I guess. Is that a dude or a guy? It looks like maybe a girl.
I'll but, watch you.
Okay. We're casting the movie already.
Yeah.
So anyway, yeah, we got Sony with Project Morpheus on the left there. We got the HoloLens. So everybody's into this stuff. I think it's going to be cool. It's really going to be cool. I think it's going to take a few more years to be really cool. And so what it'll take, like a 4 to 8K screen res. So like we're just getting right now like these 4K monitors, you know. And so I think... so somehow we got to have a 4K little thing in your eyeball, which maybe the laser guys, they already got it. I don't know. Just have to maybe have little fire extinguishers in there or something, like
little overjets.
Yeah. 60 to 120 hertz frame rate. So you have to need a very rapid, you know, and total response lag has to be less than 60 mils. When I say total response lag, I'm not talking about a deceptive spec for an LED TV. That, you know, they talk about, it's 2 millisecond, blah, blah, blah. You know, and then you plug your game controller up to it, and it's like 100 millisecond delay, which nobody tells you. LCD TVs suck. I mean, why do, you know, like, CRT has virtually no response lag. An LCD is like at least, I haven't seen anyone under 32 milliseconds.
That's why the 80s were so cool.
I know it. It was.
CRTs.
It's tight. I mean, it was
tight.
It was tight. I mean, it was like tight.
16 colors.
You know, I was playing one of the startup pinball companies down there and playing one of their games down there. And pretty cool stuff. Some really cool stuff. But it was like every now and then the flipper like didn't flip. You know, and I'm like, what the, you know, what's going on here? You know, and he's like, oh, there's a, you know, data packet overload, you know, like what, you know, like what? My flipper's on the fucking internet? You know, it's like, I mean, you know, why can't you just like, just have a wire connected to a switch, you know? You know, like, can we, you know, get back to basics here?
The 20s.
The 20s? Anyway, so it's like, but so the total response is the time, like you do something, and when does that show in the video screen? You know, that's the total response. A lot of video games today have double and triple buffering of frames, which means that if you're running at a, say, a 60 hertz frame rate, which a lot of games don't even do that, which is 16 milliseconds, if you have a triple buffered video system, basically it's writing the frame that will be displayed 48 milliseconds from now. So all of a sudden you've got a 48 millisecond lag time.
And that's perceptible. You can feel it.
Yeah, you can feel it. You know, it's a little sluggy. It's a little sluggy, and
you can feel it because you tell us about it all the
right.
time.
But then you have like a 32 millisecond monitor lag because of your amazing, you know, LED TV that you bought for $100, because you know, they're so damn cheap. All of a sudden, now you have 32 plus 48. Now you're up to 80 millisecond lag time. So they've really got to address the lag time issue. So it's a couple more years on that. I think it's going to be cool. So this is like this is actually the Magic Leap guys did some cool stuff here. They're like some, you know, gray, actually that's a gray whale. It's not a killer whale. So they don't bite. So I don't know why those people are afraid. They eat worms. Actually, gray whales eat worms. Did you know that? Yeah. But they don't have white fins like that either, so I don't know where that came from.
It's virtual reality.
Yeah, I guess that's right. Yeah, okay. Okay, so we are done. So we're opening up for questions here.
Hey, real quick, before we start questions, I just want to say, you know, Eugene invited me to come up with him, and that was very nice of him.
So you're not responsible for any of this?
No, it's not a disclaimer. I just want to say that, you know, I'm very fortunate to have made Eugene's acquaintance in 1983, and back when he was making that 500 cellar blaster. And you know, for most of us that play these games, obviously Eugene has created some really, really awesome games. I mean, I grew up playing this stuff. Eugene's been very gracious to all of us that want to make games, and you know, he's a real patron saint of this business. And you know, if he wakes up every day and wants to make games, then we're all making games. So I just want to say thank you, Eugene, for waking up every day to make games so we get to keep it going.
Yeah, and thanks to you guys for playing games, because if nobody ever played them, it wouldn't be too much fun making them, you know?
No, it
wouldn't. Okay.
Wouldn't be fun buying groceries. It'd be fun making games, though.
Question right there. Wow, that was pretty insane. That was kind of in that peak year. George got in on the 600 unit run, but
I haven't seen it yet. It's been 34 years. I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, so. I would say
maybe.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. I don't know. You know, certainly they do that on the cell phones, man.
You want to know something really interesting, though? What I've learned about this business is that there are guys, obviously, that, you know, maybe in here, people are guys that actually run coin machines. Maybe you've run them for a long time or had families that run them. But, you know, when that video game boom hit, the guys that were running games didn't know what hit them. The guys that were selling games didn't know what hit them. They're like, what is going on? You know, it was this whole new beast came in, and they all got kind of caught up in this huge, you know, whirlwind of success with video games. It was very short-lived. But had such an impact on all of us. It's just, when I talk to people, I see that we have, one of our problems when we deal with older operators is that's what they want. It's like, I want Pac-Man. It's like, well,
why isn't your game selling 900,000
Right.
You know, like,
we're trying, you know.
Why doesn't the game fill up with quarters and break due to too much cash, you know?
My point is, I don't think anybody saw it coming. It just happened. You know, and maybe that'll, you know, that's why we work every day at it. Who knows
what we'll
come up with.
I think, you know, that's it's an exercise left to the questioner, you know. I say it's always possible. I mean, that's why we're up here, you know. And that's why, you know, we're a bunch of dreamers and, you know, maybe we'll actually make a decent game one of these days. I mean, you never know. It's just, you know.
We've had moderate success. I'd say some of our driving game series have done very well. Buck Hunter, you know, has been a series that's sold, you know, quite a few thousand, more than when we made Buck Hunter, nobody expected a game to, like, a deer hunting game to sell so much.
Yeah, I guess the total Buck Hunter is over its, including all sequels, is what, 30,000-40,000 games?
Yeah, probably 40,000 games. So it's, I mean, it's not 900,000.
Yeah.
But
we're working on it. Yeah, but up at the top there.
Is there anything that you guys are working on in the future? Like, I know you guys got Batman, you got Hard Driving, you got Super Bikes, you got all these cool games. Is there anything that it's green light to talk about now in front of everybody?
Yes. Actually, George has a really cool project he's working on, but, you know, we should have brought our shameless plug for your new game, man.
Yeah, what's up with that?
I don't know.
Next time.
I think you got to
fire the presenter. The presentation. Who created that presentation? Yes, we are going to be releasing, I think in September, our next game from Play Mechanics, which is the next game out for Raw Thrills, is a MotoGP-based motorcycle circuit racer. So it's not a fantasy racer. It's more, you know, we really set out to create sort of a Daytona-style racing experience, you know, where you're in a pack, you've got guys all over you, you got to fight it out on the track every turn, and it's really, I mean, it's come out really well,
that's
right?
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's the cabinetry and all the stuff we've put on it is really awesome.
It's, I mean, a year ago, it sucked.
Actually,
it was.
I'd say like 2 months ago.
No, it was 6 months from sucking. It was that bad.
Right. I mean, and it's still one compile from sucking. But that's our next project, and probably one of the cooler features about it is you can link them in location, but they'll also link between locations. So if you're on a seat at one location and you want to play, you'll be able to play people in other locations for live head-to-head racing.
Yes.
So you guys talked about all these differentiators and like how you're making a niche for like oversized games and stuff like that.
Right.
How does the world or the relationship with the operators change when obviously these are not things that you're going to pick up and move around? Everything's moved to like destination, like Data Busters or whatever kind of setups. What about for like selling games and stuff to them? Like, you know, are they going to resell these games on to other people? I mean, like in the slots, you know, everything's like leased versus purchase. Does the economics change in some way to change?
Not really. It's still, I guess, I mean, there still is like this, you know, primary location, A locations, B locations, C locations. So the games do move down the chain, you know, eventually they get to your basement, man. But, you know, some of these things you may need a chainsaw, you know?
I don't have any of my redemption games in my basement, put it that way. You know, I don't have a prize center down there, so if I had a prize center down there.
I just feel like even the racing games are like the extreme edge, like the home buys, everyone knows like a big Daytona cabinet where it's massive. And like a lot of the examples you guys are showing of like, you know, ways of, you know, changing games and making differentiators, everything is like big, big, big.
It is.
And well, and loud.
Yeah, it is higher. I mean, you know, that's the scary thing, you know, is like, are we becoming like dinosaurs? You know, like, we're evolving into T-Rex, you know, and then like, there's
we'll
nobody
to feed
left
ourselves.
There's nobody left to eat.
Right.
You know?
We, I think, you know, from our perspective when we make the games though, if you walk into a Dave & Buster's, you have to look at the environment. You know, how do you stand out in that environment? You saw the pictures of like a Monster Drop. Monster Drop commands the room when you walk in. We need to come in with a game that at least gets you to it, right? We have to put something on the game that makes you walk to it. Now, once you get there, it's our job to make you stay with a great game. But, you know, creating a storefront that people will walk up to is really a lot of the job.
Yeah, it's kind of an ecosystem. You know, it's like peacocks. You know, it's like one guy gets all these feathers, the next dude shows up, you know, his feathers suck, and he doesn't get the ladies,
like,
you know?
If the game costs so big because you're building such a presentation, as
yeah.
you say,
yeah.
it's like the, you know, because they're, are they earning that much more to offset their...
They actually do. They actually do...
Well, they have to.
Up to
they won't make it. If they don't earn more, then it won't...
Yeah.
That's part of the ecosystem. If that game doesn't earn money, it's not going anywhere.
But it is interesting, like, you take a game, say, like, Big Bass Wheel, and probably most everybody's played one of those. Imagine if Big Bass Wheel was, like, 3 feet high. I mean, would you put a nickel in the thing? You know, I mean, no one would... It'd just be a stupid little, like, wheel, like a, you know... It's like, who cares? You know, and then all of a sudden you make it, like, 10 feet tall, like, holy shit, that's cool, you know? I mean... It's really, it's amazing. It's kind of that little kid in you, you know? Where, like, you go and, like, that's a train, it's big, wow, man, that's cool, you know? And you, the bigness is cool. But it is a danger of that we're all evolving. Maybe we're like dinosaurs and we're getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and eventually we're just, you know, getting hit by an asteroid.
That's a good game, by the way.
And it's hard to dodge that. Well, I think that would be pretty cool. And you know, as anybody, you know, if people had the privilege of going to Japan, I mean, it's a much different scene. They have some really crazy stuff. I mean, very unique environment, and they have some of the most bizarre games you'll ever imagine. You know, some of that stuff you'd probably be put in jail if you played it here. You know, I've been thinking of a few titles.
Which one you're thinking of.
But, but they, you know, they have this really unique game community. It's really a much bigger arcade, like a hardcore player community, where really the arcade today is more casual in the U.S., but Japan, they have this huge hardcore player community, and so they get some really, really neat, cool games, and I'm looking forward to it. I think that could really change the business, you know, if we bring the stuff over there. But it's something, you know, like the translation doesn't work. Like, I was down on the floor today. Anybody see Guitar Freaks? You know? And Konami invented that whole thing. And, like, they came to the U.S. and, like, nobody played it. And then, like, 5 years later or 10 years later, I don't know, whenever, like, Activision rips off the game and calls it Guitar Hero. And they were geniuses and, like, they made, you know, $5 billion, you know? So it's kind of interesting. Where
and we made Guitar Hero and sold more than Konami's Guitar
Hero.
That's
right. That's right. We ripped off that. But yeah, so it's interesting how sometimes it's a great innovation, but it may need to be adapted to, you know, our music or our culture or something.
Have you
like
you been to a round one?
I have not. I have friends that have checked them out. I think the closest, I guess, one in maybe Chicago.
There's one in Chicago.
Yeah, that might be.
But
the
you know, I went to. We go to that round one quite frequently, and. It's not a lot of Japanese games. They have some, but it's mostly, you know, they have to compete in this market. I think when they came to LA with the first round one, that's what they tried. But ultimately, you know, they're a business, right? They can bring all the games in. If they don't earn for them, then they won't bring them in. But you're right. Some of those Japanese games are incredible. I mean, the money they spend on them, you know, and just the features.
The metal games. I don't know if you've ever seen those things.
You ever see those metal games?
They have these games. It's like... the size of this entire stage. There's like, 16 stations, and you're putting like, it's kind of like pachinko, but with tokens.
You just put coins in, yeah.
And you're like throwing, you're shooting tokens at things, and there's all these like cars on railroad tracks that come and like dump tokens at you. And I mean, it's insane. You have to go on the internet and look for Japanese metal games. There's some really cool stuff. But they cost literally like $1 million for some of these games. It's just like it's like the most amazing mechanical marvel you've ever seen ever. Yes.
The resurgence of arcades and beer caves overseas downstairs.
Ben.
Is there a chance that you guys might want to tackle a game that really doesn't mark the '80s where joystick and the button you shoot an alien, it's got the cool artwork, you know, has a lot of us grew up on. If the kids, you know,
Yeah.
Right. You don't have to step it up all the way. It's like ticket machine necessarily. Right. I mean, is there a chance to get some 80s style stuff again and kind of sneaking it in there to that part?
Yeah.
Right.
I think, you know, I think it's a possibility. I think you know, it's funny, George and I being, I guess, well, speaking for myself, kind of an old timer, but George is pretty well preserved. You know? Look at that six pack on that dude, man. It's like,
shot it.
You know, it's the miracles of liposuction. You know? It's pretty.
I told you, Gene, this is the fifth version of me. So.
But, you know,
working on cloning.
What were we talking about? What were we talking about, George? Right. Oh yeah, but joysticks. Yeah, it was like forever. It was like since the fighting game boom of the 90s, you know, Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter, Tekken, Virtual Fighter, all that cool stuff. Like joysticks, it seems like joysticks have been like death for arcade. And big problem. I mean, it's so similar to a home controller. You know, it's like you couldn't differentiate. But I agree with you. I think that. I would love to like try to bring back, say, the fighting genre or maybe some of the sports games. I really think you're right. You know, I think because you see the kids now, you know, with the Kong off and some of these joystick character games, they're just so rich and they're so cool and they're very simple and easy to catch on. I agree with you. I think we have to, you know, we need to package it right. We need to find the right theme.
And it's a good idea.
Excuse me?
Cup holders.
Beer holders on the side. Okay, okay, okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So, well, one of the problems
is... Dude, are you looking for a job? Are you...
Side job? Well, one of the problems, though, like you said, it has a glow to it. I mean,
right.
There's no CRTs anymore. Everything has to be LCDs. So CRTs are just gone. So we can't manufacture new. I think we scraped the bottom. I mean, we scraped the bottom of China for CRTs, right? I think we bought the last 27-inch CRTs in China.
Yeah, we were putting them in a bucket. It was a sad day, man. I love that glow, the cathode glow, man. You get, you know, it's free radiation therapy, you know. It's like, you know, yes. That's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
You're right. And so we had to embark on a $2.5 million journey to come up with a gun system that would work on LCD panels to arcade level, which that was a fun little project.
Yeah.
We spent a lot of time on that. So if you play Buck Hunter on the floor,
yeah,
it's a HD game. So what does that mean? It has over 2 million pixels on the screen. So you have to create a gun system that can target 2 million pixels, not, you know, an old 640x480, which would be 200,000. So that was actually a huge project we had to undertake just to keep Buck Hunter going. And that's why you don't see too many people making gun games these days, because they don't have the gun system. That was something Raw Thrills designed.
Yeah, it's amazing. The CRT, they had this light gun circuit that cost like literally $2.43. And it was very accurate. And we had to throw all that shit out and do this, you know, all this crazy ass technology. And
took years.
Cameras. Yes.
We have a couple games coming that we have one for 2016, like second quarter of 2016 that you'll see, and then we have a really big one for early 2017 that I think will blow your mind. Actually,
I think, you know, anything.
No, I think
Jar Jar. I think that's. Well, we gotta get that. We gotta get the license for Jar Jar, man.
It's, yeah, like, I think that might be cheap.
Yeah,
I think I can get that one.
But now it is. I get, there's, you know, there isn't like the arcade is a public space, you know, so we can't, like, on the internet you can pretty much do whatever you want, and but in the arcade we can't harm. You know, small children, animals, and things. I guess some animals, but no, there's just a lot of things you can't do.
We don't harm anything.
Yeah, did you? Yeah, I know. It's a video game. You know,
we have something called the mommy test, which is when we make a shooting game like Aliens or Terminator, it will go to Chuck E. Cheese, and they'll put it in a, they put it in this one location, and they leave it there for like 6 months.
Yeah.
And if they get one mom complaint about the shooting, then they won't buy the game. So Terminator, apparently little Johnny can shoot robots, evil robots, and, right. and bad aliens. So we have to kind of, you know, play it safe there.
Yeah, we can't, any of you guys familiar with the game Target Terror? You know?
Yeah.
And that was kind of our last hands-off, you know.
That was the last Eugene
hands-on
shooting game.
I know. There was a lot
it
of
it had fun. Catholic schoolgirls, it had, let's see, Catholic schoolgirls.
No, he couldn't shoot. That was my daughter.
Oh, it was his daughter.
No, you can't shoot her, man. That was
but everybody did.
Yeah. I know. But no, we had, you know, exploding heads and all kinds of blood and everything. I love that game. I mean, yes. We get, you know, we get people like you
that was just last night, dude.
That are dumb enough to. What? Is that what? What'd you say, George? What'd you say?
He got it.
Anyway.
Yes, now, we are sharing a hotel room.
We are hiring people that are dumb enough to work for low money. If we have any volunteers here, you know, we just don't pay people, you know. Right?
No, we got kick-ass people in our place, man. It's not like that.
I know.
We have very, I mean, I would say our engineering staffs are, you know.
Overpaid, if anything. Certainly you are.
Overpaid? No. Hey, now. You wanted me to come here. You know, we come from a very old school of development, and we're not big on the producer system. And you see in these home companies, they create these producer systems where, yeah, they have a lot of people making games, but a lot of people are doing nothing. I mean, they're pushing paper around.
And, well, you know, you have a guy, basically you have a producer who stands behind a programmer
and
yells at him and makes sure he's not on Facebook, you know, except the producer's on Facebook, so it doesn't, you know, he doesn't know what the hell the guy's doing. But, you know, they would have so many producers, like, bugging people to supervise them. We just kind of turn people loose. So we don't have all these managers. It's a very lean development, so we only have... Even our huge games like, say, Jurassic Park or MotoGP, we only have like maybe 6 or 7 guys on the game. Or maybe what?
Maybe a few more.
Maybe 10.
Yeah, maybe 10.
10.
But it's you know, the people that we get, though, we handpick people. And, you know, Eugene and I are very hands-on with development, and we've developed for a lot of years. So we're very good about, you know, just, I don't know the best way to say it. It's just bringing them up in the way. You know, it's like... This is what you need to do. This is what you need to focus on. A lot of programming is about, of games or any project, is about picking your priorities and only working on things that have the biggest bang for the buck. And that's, I mean, that's what I learned from him early on. I was off in the weeds. When I worked on NARC, I was the lead programmer. And for a long time, we were just off in the weeds. You know, because you're making cool stuff like, you know, when the guy died, if you had the joystick up to this way and you were right in front of a door, maybe he would leave a little morsel for you. You know, these are the kind of things I would work on. And it's like, nobody saw that shit, you know. And then Eugene goes, make something cool, make right. body parts fly through the air, you know, or, make fire, you know, it's
exactly.
like, it's exactly. like, make things people want to see.
Parts so, is parts.
Right, parts is parts. And, you know, that's what you really have to be focused in your development.
Yeah, you have to think of what is the maximum impact on the player. You know, that's really what you need to focus on. And you constantly have to look at your project. Every morning you have to get up and go, what's wrong with this game? What is the most important thing to be working on today? And with, I think, smaller teams, the problem is when you get like some of these console projects and PC or even mobile projects now, I mean, they have teams of 40, 50, 70, I guess the Star Wars game, I heard there were 70 guys worked on that game.
That's Namco.
But you get so many people on a project, it's just, things fall apart. I mean, people are very tribal, and you really, once you're past 10 people, you know, the 11 through 20, they're not really working. You know, you gotta be honest, you know. Be honest with ourselves, you know, and then the problem is they don't work, and so the first 10 guys go, well, they're not working, so why the hell should I work, you know? And it's you need like a small team that is just like their back is to the wall and they're highly motivated and they have to love games. And you know, it's very hard. But, you know, yes.
Yeah.
Right.
They call it simulated 3D.
Exactly, right. Yeah.
Did that work for you?
Yes, I mean, the fishbowl guys, the game we saw, basically they use a transparent LCD. Basically, it's just an LCD, but there's not a white reflector on the back of it. I mean, so really, actually, and then you use layers of those. So you're just looking at multiple LCD displays that have, that you're just looking through them. They don't put a white reflective layer on the back of it. So that's the way they're doing it. So it's just multiple LCD screens.
And we farted around with it, but at the time, yeah. It was very expensive. Casino economy is a little different than arcade economy.
Yeah, it's a little bit different. They're making $400 a day.
Right. And guys will gladly pay $35,000 a unit or whatever. Yeah. So we looked at it. If prices come down, it's definitely something that would be applicable.
Yeah, and unfortunately, the effect is somewhat subtle. And I think, casino game... they're all kind of the same. I mean, they're all slot machines but you do something really small, you're like, oh, the screen is now curved, like, oh my God, that's amazing. It's like, it's totally different. It's a slot
machine. Now give me your $20.
slot machine with a curved screen. And now there's one little layer of transparency that's 1 inch in front of the other. Like, that's revolutionary.
It's patented, I'm sure.
Yeah, it probably is. But I think they're so bored with their own shit that they have to do something, anything to try to get attention. They have no budget, So I wish we had that kind of money to throw around, But we aren't making $400 a day. Maybe you can, George. Or maybe there's probably someone here. This man right there is going to make the $400 a day game.
Can you talk about back in like Defender, your first game? I always remember the button inputs were, really challenging. Where the control inputs for those early games, is that skill choices or just technology limitations? How did
The layout?
Up with those buttons versus choices?
Yeah, well, basically Defender, that was back, we were working on that, was back in 1980. And actually, I really wanted to put a joystick on that game. But at that point, I couldn't actually find a joystick vendor. So it's like... Basically, instead of a four-way joystick, you had the up-down stick, which was from Space Invaders, and then you had a reverse button, and use the thrust fire asteroid thing. But it turned out that control was a lot better than a joystick. It really had a lot more freedom of motion, and it turned out it was brilliant. I made it kind of to fit my hand, and it kind of fits the average hand, so it's laid out in that fashion. So we really didn't worry about ergonomics. We just didn't have a lot of devices to play around with. And so you took what was available and laid it out and tried to make it happen. And personally, I think Defender worked out pretty well. But it was,
Fun factor speaks for itself.
Yeah, I still feel good playing. Although I didn't see Defender, I saw they had one of those, new Repla Fenders or something down there. And that was a Stargate. I didn't see a Defender. There's something, you gotta get the original game.
So you know what game was at the same show Defender was at, right? Pac-Man was there. Pac-Man was at the same show. So here you have a game with, one joystick, eat some dots.
I know, they had a joystick, man. Where did they get that?
Yeah, and then you've got Eugene's game, and I think people were like, that thing was just like... It's just mean, That game was just brutal. And it's so amazing that it took off the way it did because, you felt like a maestro when you were playing that game.
That's why I wonder if it was a skill kind of choice, for the play and, challenge or whatever.
I just don't think you knew when to stop.
It definitely was. I was trying to make it easy. I failed. But it was really about, it attracted a real hardcore player. Although the first week, the average game time was 38 seconds. People didn't know. Actually, they didn't know you could thrust. They actually thought it was just sideways Space Invaders, and they just went up and down, and they'd be shooting the thing, and all of a sudden, one of these mutants would start coming down on them, and and they were dead. A lot of people didn't come back. It was a very hardcore experience. I think probably 95% of the people that played Defender never came back, but for some reason. There was a 5% out there that
5% just, was good enough in the market.
That was just totally in love with the game. Yes.
I came back, but I still suck at it.
Well, thank you for all the quarters. But it's players that suck that actually pay for us. Because the good players, they play like a quarter for months, you know, like, yeah. We, you know, you make no money off of those guys.
Make no money off those guys.
So it's really, we
wherever love. Billy Mitchell is, you know, we didn't make any money off that guy.
Exactly, right?
Or Richie.
Okay, one more here.
Question.
Yeah.
The game defender.
Yeah.
Some of the Williams hits that sound
off the line. He wrote all that stuff, man.
Yeah. Basically, they were, most of those sounds, because actually, I was originally a sound designer. That was, that's how I started out. Anyway, any guys are like sound designers here, or sound mixers, or, you know, whatever. Okay. Anyway, I just love that. And so most of those sounds were from a pinball game called Firepower. You know, if anybody ever played that one. And so that was the basis for, like, literally for about 10 years, Williams games, you know, from, you know, Defender, Stargate, Robotron, Joust, Sinistar, all those, all their hot games from that golden era use the same sound package pretty much. And, you know, we do a few others, but, you know, it was like, it just kept working. You know, as long as it keeps selling, why make a new sound? You know, it's like
those sounds were created by a microprocessor, a DAC, a genius, and a lot of mind-altering substances. <like they. laughs> Those sounds are the best sounds.
You know, somehow
in the industry.
I don't have the brain cells to remember that anymore.
You listen to those sounds. I mean, I remember hearing that stuff when it first came out of the speakers. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. You know,
actually,
I was just like, what is this? Well, actually, remember, you know, Flash. I remember when I played Flash the first time, it scared the crap out of me. I wouldn't play it anymore because I thought I was going to get electrocuted, you know, because the sounds just it scared me.
But actually, if you ever have the privilege of getting like a Defender soundboard, you can actually trigger the sounds by just, if you create a little switch box, you know, just toggle like 6 bits or something. And some of those sounds actually literally last like 5 or 10 minutes. They keep evolving. And it's like a symphony. It's like a, and I someday I'm going to put out the CD of all these sounds.
Long play.
No, it is. Yeah, because you're not hearing a tenth of those sounds.
This one is called humanoid pickup.
Yeah. it is. No, there was some really cool stuff there, man. You got to prepare to listen to them, though.
I've done that.
It's like the Grateful Dead. You have to kind of, you know, get ready and be in a mellow place.
I always wanted to put one of those soundboards when I first started at Williams. I wanted to grab a Sinistar soundboard and put like the trigger box, put it in my car.
Yeah.
You know, and have the speaker out the front. Go to the drive-through line. Go to the drive-through line.
That's right. Hunger.
That's right.
Then just start screaming.
Beware. Beware, coward!
That would be funny.
Was that a cheeseburger?
Any more questions? We got any more? Yeah.
So I think a lot of the resurgence in pinball is because now selling these machines, people like myself are collecting them all.
Yeah.
I have a Stargate at home, a Robotron at home. Yeah. Today, for the first time, my son and I is four playing your big box. I really loved it. It's like, whenever you can get one of these. But it's not really marketed for people like me to buy at home.
But you can, of course. But you know.
Yeah.
I come here and I go, man, these people are paying like $8,000 for a pinball game. It's like, shit, man.
We don't get $8,000 for our games.
I know. It's like, but I would love to sell. You know, I think it's a great untapped market because I thought our games were, a lot of people were playing them, and I think they would be great in people's basements.
We do a direct to home version where we strip off, you know, a lot of the pricier components like the dollar bill validator and things like that, and brings the price down. Do we still have those, Jeff? Do we still do home units? Yeah. So we do that. I mean, that is possible.
Yeah.
See the guy in the yellow shirt right there?
Yeah.
Talk to him after the...
Yeah, talk to Jeff. But yeah, I think one thing after coming to the show, we feel like, hey, man, maybe we can sell some games.
Yeah. Oh, we're
we'd love to. We'd love
stuff.
To target.
Like what you said, do you want to make an old 8-bit game? Yes, I do. The answer is yes. You know, but I'll get fired if I make too many of them because they won't sell. That's a problem.
You're negative, man. You're so negative.
I'm so negative.
You know, you're so like in the 80s, dude.
You never
know.
Yes,
right
here.
There's this new console thing coming out.
I'm not, by the way.
I don't know what it's called, but I know that they used the mold for the Atari Jaguar.
Okay.
And it's legit a new console thing. Like, my buddy made a game for it.
Is it the Cheetah? The Cheetah, the no copyrights? No. It's all free, baby. The Cheetah.
I wish I had a name for it.
Okay.
There's collectors out there that would buy New Mutant games, believe me. They would buy. They would sell. Don't get discouraged.
Yeah, don't get discouraged, dude.
Don't get discouraged about that. There's a lot of classic games.
No,
you guys, don't give me a hard time here. If anybody's going to beat the drum for a classic arcade in our company, it's going to be me, okay? Just don't think it won't be.
Yes, Richie.
So, what you're telling me is, I got to go to that guy in the yellow shirt to get my stupid doodle jump you've been promising me for 3 years now?
Whoa. Hey, we'll meet you outside, dude.
I want my doodle jump.
We'll meet you outside.
Yeah, you can download it for free, I think. There you go. Done.
Just mount your fucking iPhone on a cabinet. See how that works for you, buddy.
People like me working for him. No, I'm just kidding.
Yes, that's right. That's true. We're getting more and more into Linux these days.
Play Mechanics has always been Linux.
Yeah.
Trying to get those guys.
Remember the Windows thing. I don't know, I meant this.
I did all that, and it was no fun getting that thing working on.
Yeah, I really, development is really going that way, and although it seems like, maybe 5 or 10, at some point it may all be Android. We're all Ruby on Rails.
That's a variant, right?
Ruby on Rails, whatever that shit is. JavaScript, Python, Ruby on Rails.
This room's gonna be struck down pretty soon.
Whatever this stuff is.
Get out of here. Man.
Yeah.
There you go.
That's what I want to strip out all this crap. Let's get back down to assembly language. Man.
Yeah.
Everything else is bullshit.
It is.
Why do people do it?
Because they're lame. They don't want to take the time to read the book.
Any more questions? Any more? We're on such a roll, man. Everybody's in the quiet. I guess
you can't follow my question.
What? Asking for free crap?
Yes.
Okay, so back when the microprocessor first came out, it's clear from certain software archaeology, he did some amazing stuff. There was no internet to learn from. There were no stack of books you could buy. How did you figure it out?
It was amazing. It was a lot of self-taught guys who were into that thing. And you know what's really amazing? I guess the guy who wrote Space Invaders, Japanese guy who wrote that, he did not have an assembler. He basically typed in the machine codes with hex. You know, it was like typed in with hex, and I mean, it blows. Actually, and there was a guy. This is an amazing story. Robotron. I just loved. That's my favorite game that I worked on. But it turned out there was this kind of bug. If you shoot into the upper right corner with a diagonal shot, every 400 games, basically your bullet would go through off the screen, and just off the screen is where we stored the program stack. And basically, so you'd shoot a bullet through your program stack, which would not
be killed your program.
Wasn't a good thing for your code, and the game would crash. And we looked at it a million times, this collision routine is bulletproof. How could this happen? And then I think about it, 3 or 4 years after we put out the game, a kid in Canada, his name was Christian Gingras, called us up, and he had spent they got some long winters up there. He had spent like a year hand disassembling the code, like taking the machine code and figuring out what instructions there were, writing it all out on 200 pages of computer paper. And then he came, he had this whole disassembled listing of the program. And they said, oh, by the way, I found 17 bugs. that were in the code. And one of them was that problem. There was 16 other bugs that just really stupid shit, like forgetting like at the end of routine to like return. They would just like fall into some other shit, you know?
Which made really cool things happen.
Yeah.
Like, does anybody know the Mikey bug? Do you know the Mikey bug? Like on the brainwave where all the brains target Mikey first. That's one of those non-initialized yeah. array of bugs that yeah. is really cool, by the way, because if you can do it, you know, you can yeah. score huge.
Well, yeah, some of the best features were bugs on those assembly language programs. You know, it created buggier code, which created a more interesting program than you could do on your own, which was cool. But
I'm going to follow up on that. I'm going to tell you why Eugene wrote what he did, because I work for him and I understand it. Eugene stops at nothing to get the most out of the minimum. So I think it was a challenge for him. And he, you know, that's what he does. He's like the cheapest guy I know, really. You know, he literally will squeeze the maximum out of anything he's got.
I got a Prius, man. That says it all. It says it all.
But no, and that's really what it is.
You can fit a fucking video in the back of that thing, man. That has a huge trunk, man. It's not that I'm just fucking cheap. I mean,
he's very generous. Cheap, I'm not saying he's tight. He's just, I'm serious, this is a serious talk. When I think the drive on that, because we used to have to do that in our games, just keep going over and over it and make it faster. You know, let's take, if we can take components out by making the processor do something, like if you look at Defender, that's just the processor. The processor draws every pixel. It does all the calculations of everything.
There's just a bitmap and a processor.
Right, there's no coprocessors going on, and if you get in there and really go into that code, there's some pretty crazy crap happening.
But yeah, it was, you know what bugs me though? Is when they emulate that, like this thing is running at 1 megahertz. When they emulate that on a 3 gigahertz PC, and the frame rate is crappy, and that thing like stutters.
What was yours, like 1 megahertz? Was it 1 megahertz?
Yeah, 1 megahertz. So they take a 3,000 times more powerful computer, and it still can't run the code. That's progress. That's progress. But it was, you know, actually, we actually had to spend, there was nights I spent, we had to save like 5 bytes. And so you'd have to go through your program like, I need to save 5 bytes. It doesn't fit, you know, it's like 40 bits, you know? It's stupid. It was stupid.
Call me stupid?
No, I was stupid. okay, anybody else? Okay, yeah.
How did you make the switch from Atari to Windows?
So I was into pinball in those days. You know, like a lot of you guys? You know, pinball, I was a pinball freak, and I was doing pinball games, and I just loved pinball, and I thought video sucked. And Atari, they were shutting down the pinball department. So, because their games, they had some cool games, but they tended to catch on fire. You know, like, there's that new TV show, like, Halt and Catch Fire or something. And I think they were talking about Atari games. Atari pinball games, in particular. Their sales were kind of not doing so well due to the burning down bars and stuff.
It's not good to burn down a guy's bar.
It's not cool to burn down the bar.
Yeah.
But so that's why I ended up with Williams and Steve Ritchie.
It can happen when you make video games.
Yeah, and Steve Ritchie was in, which is cool. That was like the other cool thing. I mean, I tell you, I learned so much working under Steve Ritchie. It's amazing. He was pretty cool.
Well, ultimately though, Steve Ritchie was recruited to Chicago by Williams. And I think Steve, when they recruited him, one of Steve's deals was he wanted Eugene to go with him, right? I mean, he kind of said, I want this guy going with me.
Well, I was out in California. And then I went to Chicago in like January. And I said, man, I am never, ever going to move to Chicago. never! And then I think it was about a year later, Steve called me up and goes, shit, my programmer quit. It's like, Steve went through programmers he still goes through programmers. He's kind of a tough guy to work with, but so he talked me into going to Chicago. And they tripled my salary, so that was all right too. So
makes the winter a little warmer.
I was making 12 grand a year then. So that was some good money, man. Yes, right there.
Try another game.
What's
sorry. You ever play Pac-Man? No. Okay, what's the secret?
You know, I'm curious what your average points are.
On Robotron, it's a big difference between an average and a high. You know, it's like, I would say Robotron, my average is maybe, sadly, you know, and I'm not getting any better, maybe like 120,000 or 30,000. But if I'm really, you really almost have to play it for like an hour before you're warmed up. And yeah, but you have to get warmed up, and then you have to really hate your machine. You know, I mean, you have to get to the point that you are in a, like a, at least that's the way I do it. I'm not like one of these cerebral type players.
He does. We lose a lot of glasses, monitor glasses to Eugene.
I don't think I've quite broken a million, but in the high 900s. And if you really, you can get in a zone with that game. And it just, it's, you feel like, you feel immortal. Yeah. You know, and it just like, you can do no wrong and you just plow right through the grunts. But you just have to play it a lot. And there's this website Mark Hoff puts together, like Williams Players Unite or something. Anybody know about that? You know? Look at like Robotron tips. I wrote a strategy guide in that website, which I think could help your game. No, it's because it's very cerebral. There's a lot of tricks in Robotron. One thing weird about it, it's actually less dangerous to get close to enemies. Like your instinct is trying to flee from them, but the farther away you flee from them, the faster their shots are. So actually you want to be closer to them, which is completely non-intuitive and against all human instinct. But you really want to get close to them. You want to have like a circular motion so that their shots keep going where you were formerly and not where you're going to.
And,
right, the enforcers, yeah. So there's a lot of interesting strategies, but look on the internet for like Robotron strategies by Eugene Jarvis. And no, really, I'm serious.
Well,
you will be into 500,000s by next week.
One quick point. When we play at our place, Robotron, it's always on level 10, though. So it makes brings your average down quite a bit.
But that's cool, though. Because it's kind of like...
Play on level 10 and then put it down to like level 4 and then all of a sudden...
Right, then you go down to stock and it's like, you know... You're,
right, you'll really, just, you'll play forever.
You're really rocking. So, yeah.
Yes.
Is there?
I think there is. Easiest. Okay. Zero to 9.
Okay,
yeah.
Zero. Okay, yeah. Okay.
There is.
Are you fucking kidding? Dude, man, that's... you like have a higher voltage in it or something? Okay.
I got it.
Yeah, maybe you could. I wonder what 11 would do, man. You could probably sneak that code into the CMOS.
The emulator.
Yeah. Anybody else? Is there any more talks here? Probably are. That's the Sharp Brothers. That's right. All right. Well, I think. What time is it, George?
9.
9 o'clock. We gotta get out of here. So.
Eugene, you are awesome.
Thank you. And thanks, George.
All right, thanks for listening to us, guys. It was a lot of fun.
I hope you had as much fun as we did. It was great. Thank you.
Kick ass. Yeah, we're out of here.